I feel like it's the perfect time for this video. In a little over 2 weeks, we see the release of Fallout 76's Wastelanders DLC, giving many of us the opportunity to give that game a try in a totally different context. But in the lead up to that, we of course have had some pretty interesting things happening in the world. A real life virus affecting many people, causing mass shutdown pretty much across most countries. So it feels like a pretty good time to actually discuss or give you an explanation on the plague that wiped out Fallout 76's Appalachia. A little bit of background for Wastelanders, as this seemingly will be a very relevant part of what's to come next, and having this backstory will definitely be valuable, but also it's just really interesting. Despite me not being a huge fan of the way stories are told in Fallout 76 in that passive storytelling manner, many of the stories themselves are really good and extremely interesting. So in this video, I'm going to explain to you what exactly the Scorched Plague is, where it came from, how it came to be, and of course, how it eventually wiped out everyone in an entire region. So naturally, if you've never played Fallout 76, or like many of us, just played a little bit here or there, this contains spoilers for the story overall, and that's your last warning on that one. Following the bombs dropping in Appalachia, things were bad, but frankly not quite as bad as everywhere else. We saw the persistence and establishment of several factions, the rise of the Raiders, the Free States maintaining their locations and actually being relatively safe in their bunkers, but then even an effort to actually help some of the locals affected by the situation with the responders. And considering there was no major direct hits in this area, things were largely okay. And actually, that was the problem. Following the bombs dropping and loss of contact with larger Enclave Command, Thomas Eckert took control of the White Springs base for the Enclave and really the Enclave in the region overall. Anybody not aligned with the faction or dissenting him were eliminated, and he really had a core and fundamental goal. He wanted to fight communism and do so with all of the options available to him, including the many nukes we could find all throughout Appalachia. Now during this time, as we could actually see somewhat in-game, quite a bit of experimentation was going on at the White Springs bunker. Different serums were being developed, several of which we can now get in-game as characters, but during some of this testing and experimentation, an accident happened. Some of the recently found irradiated bats were exposed to biochemical experiments that were going on, which in turn led to the very first Scorch Beasts in the area. Eckert, seeing the power and potential of these creatures, actually ordered further study of them, this taking place at the abandoned AMS mining complex. Although, all the while he was doing this, he kept the rest of the Enclave and non-essential personnel in the dark about this experimentation. All the while, Eckert still had a very clear goal of using nuclear weapons to resolve this ideological conflict when it came to communism and communists. But there was actually one pretty big problem around this. Several safeguards were in place, not allowing him, even with a newly attained presidential status, to actually launch these nukes on his own. He needed a general to be with him, but also, one of the biggest barriers to entry, he needed Modus's automated systems to read Appalachia as having a DEFCON 1 status. And although things were bad in the wake of the nuclear war that came with the Great War, they weren't quite that bad, and Modus still was not reading a DEFCON 1, and in turn, Eckert was unable to launch nukes even if he wanted to. But that's where his alternate plan came into action. In order to force DEFCON 1, he first attempted by releasing the Liberators into Appalachia. That wasn't enough, so he followed it up by releasing the Super Mutants that were also a byproduct of local experimentation. And even though each of those caused havoc, neither of them were enough either. So finally, he released the Scorch Beasts, those little creatures he found based on that accidental exposure in the past into the area, and this did the trick. During some of the earlier testing, Scorch Beasts were slowly escaping on accident, but in relatively small quantities. But as the full-fledged release did occur, these Scorch Beasts already had a home made for themselves, and seemingly several caverns were set up throughout the area. The Scorch Beasts themselves were powerful in more ways than one. Of course, as you've experienced in-game, they're just an absolute nightmare to fight. They could fly up high and just braid you with screech attacks, which deal massive amounts of damage and can very easily wipe out an unarmored human. But a secondary effect of these guys that may have not even been known by the Enclave scientist or Eckert as they were running their experimentation, they also spread the Scorched Plague, which is in fact that green gas attack that comes out of them as they fly over. Now this affects everything. You can find many Scorched variants of other mutated creatures. Of course, the Scorched themselves, which is a human impacted by the Scorched Plague, but this isn't instant. Over time, humans impacted by the Scorched Plague will stop exhibiting higher cortical functions, aka they just got dumber. as well as visually, they would gradually transform between a human body to a scorched body that you could find now, developing what almost looks like charred skin. And although this most clearly affected other humans as well as irradiated creatures that you could find throughout the area, it also had an impact on other irradiated bats. So as the scorched beasts were released, they actually created more scorched beasts. As they made their way into genuine bat caverns, they too were infected with the plague, and over time, those bat caverns turned into scorched beast caverns, and the spread just continued. Although with this particular plague and humans, it was really a slow death sentence. When the scorched weren't engaging in their almost automated function of attacking other non-scorched, they would stand still, like weirdly still. And if they stood still too long, they would actually enter into the final stage of the plague. If the scorched stand still for too long, they'll actually petrify from the inside out. And that's why all throughout Appalachia, you could actually find petrified corpses all over. These are humans infected by the scorched plague converted to scorched that just stood still for too long. But there also is a mind control component to this. It seems like when animals or humans are infected by the scorched plague, they actually are almost a hive mind, with everything being controlled by the scorched beast queen and them working in unison. As the scorched beasts and in turn the scorched plague were released and spread throughout Appalachia, initially most people didn't believe it. The Appalachian Brotherhood of Steel under Paladin Taggarty were the first to discover the plague and the scorched beast. As they tried to warn others, initially people didn't believe them, or simply in denial at how bad things were looking. But very quickly things spread. As additional bats were infected with the scorched plague, over time the scorched beasts would actually claw their way out from underground caverns, and that's the fissures you could find all throughout Appalachia. Here they would destroy towns, infect additional humans with the plague, or just outright kill them. Now as this spread and affected more and more people, the factions of Appalachia tried to actually combat this. Initially, just by taking down these scorched beasts themselves and actually creating ultracite weapons to go against them, it was discovered by the responders' fire breathers that depleted ultracite was quite effective in combating these scorched beasts, and weaponry was designed by the Brotherhood of Steel. And although despite efforts at a cure and even just wiping out these scorched beasts altogether were developed, nothing ended up delivering. The Brotherhood of Steel had an ultimate goal of launching a nuke to finish them off completely, but they failed. And as we awake from Vault 76, we find the wake of their failure. Although during the main story of Fallout 76, following in the Vault 76's Overseer's footsteps, we could pretty quickly put the pieces together. The responders were very close to completing an inoculation project, a cure to the scorched plague that would actually prevent you from being infected in the first place. Taking the existing research and connecting some of the dots, we're able to actually finish this project and inject ourselves with the cure, which is why we are never actually turned into a scorch throughout the main story of Fallout 76. And of course, with the end of the game, actually putting all of the research and data from these factions together, you can launch a nuke at Fissure Site Prime and actually destroy the scorch beasts altogether. This is the same approach taken by the Brotherhood of Steel, and although initially it seemed like it worked, after a certain amount of time, scorched beasts started coming up out of the ground again. And it's not totally clear if at the end of Fallout 76, after defeating the scorched beast queen, if we're successful or not. You see, in Fallout 76, technically speaking, it's just one day. You leave the vault in chase of the Overseer on the morning of October 23rd, 2102, and somehow actually complete the whole main quest and kill the Scorched Beast Queen by the end of that same day. Now with Wastelanders, maybe we'll see some variation in this, maybe that timeline is actually over weeks or maybe even months. But with Wastelanders itself, things take place 1 year later. And seemingly, based off the first trailer we got at last year's E3, things aren't totally over. A scorched beast is clearly flying overhead, and maybe that's just a cinematic shot, but frankly I have a feeling Bethesda didn't outright remove what is a big chunk of the game and combat encounters you could have in the game, but that still does leave the problem of, well, people getting the plague. We've discussed in this video how just contracting the scorched plague basically slowly devolves you into a totally different being, and then if you stop moving, you're screwed. Wastelanders will definitely have to address this somewhat. The scorched beasts are still flying around, the plague is still being spread, so there's gonna have to be some kind of method to actually inoculate people on a wide scale. In the base story of Fallout 76, we create the cure, but we never really create a way to mass spread it. We inject ourselves because, quite literally, we're the only person there, as well as other Fallout 76 dwellers who hypothetically do the same thing. There also is that massive curiosity as to what actually motivates people back to Appalachia, considering the entire population of the region was just wiped out by a plague. And based off this, the plague creators are still there, so did they just come back crossing their fingers none the wiser? I do hope Bethesda addresses that. Also, we know that there will seemingly be a motivation with the treasure of Appalachia we've seen that referred to numerous times, but can you get this many people back into a region just for some treasure even while there's a plague still actively being spread? These are some major plot points that hopefully will be in Wastelanders. It's one of those things that I think if they don't address will be a major critique from me around Wastelanders. It's not something minor you could just ignore, it was the justification for literally not having a human the first time around. But either way, that is the full story and explanation as to what Fallout 76's Scorched Plague is. It's bad. The Scorched Beasts are a major threat in the area even still, and I'll be curious to see how this is expanded upon or addressed with Wastelanders, which now is only 2 weeks away. As always again, I thank you all for watching, hope you enjoyed this video. If you are excited for Wastelanders, over the next couple of weeks I'm going to have a few videos specifically designated towards everything we know about it, what you need to know about Fallout 76 going into Wastelanders if you maybe took a break, and even a bit more, including my own coverage of the DLC once it's here. As always again, I thank you for watching, I hope you enjoyed this one, and I hope to see you all next time. Later.